Okay, students, we're ready to get rolling here, finally. I mean, we've talked about the class, we've introduced the class. You've watched a presentation on Cornell Notes, you've set up your class blogs. I guess it's time to do some history. And today's presentation is just going to be an introduction. There's some important information here. This is really going to set up the class perfectly. Now, I'd like you to try to fill out a Cornell template as we roll through this presentation. And we have two essential questions in this presentation. First of all, can you describe an early civilization? And what is perspective and bias? So we're going to be talking about early civilizations and the important concept of perspective and bias, which we're going to hit a lot during this entire semester. But first of all, I want to introduce this concept of a complex society. I mean, generally what people say is that, you know, when did civilization begin? But civilization is a value judgment, because if someone calls you uncivilized, they're not paying you a compliment. So we're going to take away the judgment out of this equation and just refer to these early societies as complex societies. Now, when did these evolve? That's a good question. I mean, it's not a hard and fast number. I'm going to give you some generalities here. In 10,000 BCE was the Neolithic Revolution. Neolithic is a highfalutin word for the agricultural revolution. And you have to understand how significant this was. People went from being nomads and going from place to place to place to people started to produce their own food, which is very significant. Hello, students. Well, we're ready to start history, finally. I mean, we've been talking about all kinds of things. We did Cornell Notes. I gave you an introductory lecture. We set up our class blogs. I think it's finally time to start doing some history. And this is a great presentation to set up the entire semester. I'd like you to fill out some Cornell Notes, a Cornell Notes template, as we work our way through this presentation. And we have two essential questions that we're going to address. One, can you describe an early civilization? And the second one is this important concept of what is perspective and bias? And we're going to deal with that a lot during the semester. Now, what we have to do is we have to peg a time, peg an era when civilization began, but we're not going to refer to it as civilization. Civilization is a value judgment. I mean, if someone calls you civilized, they're paying you a compliment. Or if they call you uncivilized, they're definitely dissing you. So we're going to use the term complex society, COMSOC. And I'm going to talk about what exactly that is. And it's tough to peg to a time period. A Neolithic revolution that took place in the world roughly about 10,000 BCE was very significant. Neolithic's a highfalutin word for agricultural revolution. And this was significant because people went from being nomads, going from place to place to place, to settling in one place because they could produce their own food. Now, the urban revolution took place around 5,000 BCE, and we're just talking about small settlements. And the great thing about the urban revolution is people then could specialize in what they do best. It was the beginning of artisans. But as far as when did complex societies emerge, you have to look at about 3,700 BCE to about 2,200 BCE. So this time period of roughly 1,500 years was very significant. Now, I'm gonna tell you something about these early complex societies. They generally emerged or evolved in similar places. Now, don't get too concerned if you're not able to catch all these places, because we're gonna do a geography activity at the end of this presentation where you can find these places on the map. But the first great civilization emerged in Western Asia, in the modern nation of Iraq, between two river valleys. You know, river valleys are fertile places to grow food. Makes sense that societies evolved there. Between two river valleys called the Tigris and the Euphrates. And in between these two valleys, or river valleys, is this area called Mesopotamia. And that's what people think was the original complex society on Earth. Northeastern Africa along the Nile River also had a complex society. Eastern China, there's two major rivers that drain across Eastern Asia, and they move from the interior west out to the Pacific Ocean. That's the Huang He and the Yangtze River, and that's around these rivers and in between these rivers is where early China emerged. On the island of Crete in the Mediterranean is where Greek civilization began. In the mountainous, foreboding country of Peru in South America, in the Supa River Valley, you saw the emergence of Comsocs. And finally, along the Gulf Coast Plain in Mexico, as in the Gulf of Mexico, Yucatan Peninsula, you see the emergence of early civilizations. Now, one thing that's very typical, or that's common among these early sacred states, is early Comsocs that were sacred states, is they were all theocracies. And what I mean by a theocracy is that God gave the king power. These were sacred states. The early Comsocs were sacred states or theocracies. In other words, a lot of times the leader was considered a god or an emissary of God. There was absolutely no separation of church and state. Now, this contrasts to most contemporary states like the United States, which are secular. In other words, their power derives from the will of the people. That's not the way those early societies worked. This is a great image of the step pyramid at Dozier, which is one of the earliest pyramids, probably dates back to about 3000 BCE. And today we do still have some theocracies. I'd say Saudi Arabia is a theocracy, Iran is a theocracy. Something else that's very evident in these early Comsocs is this significant wealth gap. The ruling class is very tiny, but they derive most of their wealth from the vast number of the population who were poor peasants. And these poor peasants paid high taxes, turned over a large part of their harvest to the wealthy, it's tenant farming, and they provided the labor for large public works projects like the pyramids in Egypt. Now keep in mind, these early Comsocs were theocracies, so this activity was like the modern tithe, and early citizens were not resentful. In Egypt, the whole population spent a good part of their life building pyramids, which were monuments to dead kings. It's like spending your entire life building your grave, which is awed by modern stances. Something else that emerged in these early Comsocs is this beautiful early forms of writing. Now, I have a few images here which are just spectacular. This is the earliest form of writing, probably dates back to about 3000 BCE. It comes from Mesopotamia. It's called cuneiform. And you can see there's different slashes and wedges and kind of horn shapes. And this writing was put on these heavy clay tablets. Now, the world's first book was written about 2000 BCE. It's called the Epic of Gilgamesh. And guess what it's about? What happens to you when you die? Isn't that fascinating? So the world's first book was not like Jack jumped up and down or Sea Spot Run. It was about what happens to you after death. I think that that's just wonderful. And this is the earliest forms of writing in China. This is a scapula of a cow. And it has interesting writing on it. It's called an oracle bone. The ancient Chinese put these on bones from animals and tortoise shells. And then a priest did something very interesting, which we're going to learn about in this unit. Oracle bones probably date back to about 1500 BCE. They're newer than cuneiform, but they're the earliest form of writing in Asia, or well, I should say East Asia. And then most of us are familiar with these beautiful symbols from Egypt, which are almost as old as cuneiform. Hieroglyphics are these interesting pictures that are quite mesmerizing. Interesting story about hieroglyphics. In 1799, a French soldier walking through the desert in Egypt tripped over a large black stone. They dug out the stone and it had all kinds of hieroglyphics, plus all kinds of other scripts that archaeologists could decipher. And so for the next 20 years, they started to match these up. And that was the key to understanding hieroglyphics. And today, if you want to learn another language, you can also do the Rosetta Stone language, which is named after this wonderful artifact, of which there's a full-scale replica in the Ohio State University Library. Now, one thing that's really important to understand about these early forms of writing, bam, were these were tools of oppression. It's kind of hard for us to think about learning in that way, but early writing was a technology to which the ruling class had access, but the vast majority of people did not. What early writing tells us about these Comstocks is the way wealthy people lived, but little about the lives of ordinary people, which comprise the bulk of civilization. And sorry, I couldn't resist. I just had to show you a comic I drew about early forms of writing. Okay, this is a very important topic, perspective. Perspective is just your lens on the world, how you see the world. But it is incredibly variable. It changes from person to person. Here's a good example right here. This is the stone path outside of my house. Now, I walk over this stone path on a daily basis and never pay one lick of attention to it. But last week, before school started, for some odd reason, I decided to lay down in the gravel stones and have a closer look. And what I saw was beautiful. These little stones are magical, and like snowflakes, they have their own character and composition. So, of course, I took out my cell phone and took a picture of the stones, and it just gives me this whole new appreciation for the stone walk that I stomp across on a daily basis. But perspective is important in this class because we're going to try to look at things from a different perspective, which can be so enlightening. Now, bias, on the other hand, is a negative term. With bias, what you see is you see an inclination to present or hold a perspective that at the expense of perhaps equally valid alternatives. Now consider Fox News and MSNBC on election night. Fox wants the Republican to win, MSNBC wants the Democrat to win, and then these two news agencies will report an identical event very differently. They'll probably purposefully omit valid evidence which promotes legitimate views from the other side. Now, Americans are not immune to bias. Look at this image right here. This is a famous British imperialist by the name of Cecil Rhodes, and he is straddling the continent of Africa like he is conquering the whole thing. He obviously could care less about the poor people who live there. And we're going to combat this thing called Eurocentrism in this class. We're going to get out of our Western mindset. And by Western, I mean societies like the United States that are the product of Western Europe. Now, here's a great example of Eurocentrism exposed in this brief clip from Malcolm X. Now, the volume's a little low on this, so go ahead and turn up your volume so you can hear. And if you can't hear, you can just look it up online. But this is Malcolm X in a jail in New England challenging a pastor about the race of Jesus.
The thief, to steal and to kill and to destroy. But I am come that they might have life, that they might have it more abundantly. St. John 10, verse 10. Are there any questions?
Watch, baby. This gate is heavy on me.
See, this has become a struggle between good and evil. Satan has a question.
Yes, sir, Chaplain Gill, but since neither one of us are God, I don't think either one of us are in any position to say who's good and who's evil.
Why don't you just ask your question?
We were discussing the disciples. What color were they?
I don't think we know that for certain.
But they were Hebrews, were they not?
That's right.
As was Jesus. Jesus was also a Hebrew.
Why don't you just ask your question?
What color were the original Hebrews?
I have told you that we don't know that for certain.
Then you can't believe for certain that Jesus was white.
Just a moment.
God is white. Isn't it obvious?
Well, that is obvious, but we don't know if it's obvious that God is white. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that Jesus did not have blonde hair and blue eyes. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that the images of Jesus that are on prison walls and churches throughout the world are not historically correct, because history teaches us that Jesus was born in a region where the people had color.
There's proof in the very Bible that you ask us to read in Revelation 1st chapter, verse 14 and 15, that Jesus had hair like wool and feet the color of brass.
Just what are you saying?
I'm not saying anything. I'm proving to you that Jesus was not, and I might quote one of our Indian brothers, he was not a pale face. Amen.
Wow, you talk about stirring the pot, man. You start talking about the ethnicity of Jesus, but what Malcolm X says does make sense. If you think of modern-day Israel or ancient Palestine, the people that came from those regions were dark-complected. And yet what we see in a lot of church walls here in North America and Western Europe is Jesus looks like he's from Norway or something like that. Now, one thing that's a little unfair in this is Malcolm X is quoting the book of Revelations, which is obviously filled with some pretty spectacular imagery, but boy, it gets you thinking. Hey, you did a great job with this. Now what I want you to do is to get into your groups and compare notes. Compare your Cornell note template and see if you got similar things. If you think one of your neighbors wrote something down that was worthy, then by all means, ask if you can copy down what they wrote. But this is where we're going to work together. Okay, that's lecture one.